Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Covenant Cast. I'm Zach.
And I'm Steven.
And I'm Alex.
And today we're talking about miniature war games with Alex Davy. All right, what have you guys been up to this week?
Well, this week is Labor Day. So, Alex, I imagine you maybe did something for Labor Day as well, but I go to the lake. That's kind of my Labor Day ritual with my my wife's side of the family, and do some pretty serious lake stuff, like wake surfing and barefoot skiing.
I saw some videos.
Those are funny. Serious lake sports.
Yeah, they're very serious. Like, so barefoot skiing is one of the weirdest things. It's essentially skiing with no skis on, right? You're literally just on your feet. But the way that it works is you have to get a boat going 35 miles per hour about before you even try to get skiing. So during that time, you're just being dragged in the water. and the reality is that until you're really good at it, you never can really do it very well. So you're just
most of the time you're just getting dragged through the water.
You're getting dragged through the water, and then you're turning your body, putting your feet in, getting launched, you know, into space, attempting to hold on and then tumbling through the water and trying not to knock yourself unconscious. So if you're into those kinds of things, I suggest it in terms of serious lake sports, but otherwise maybe stick to some other things during Labor Day. But I certainly enjoyed it. And it's kind of a rite of passage for me as the new guy in the family. You know, I'm kind of expected, I think, to do that. And so I don't want to, like, let anybody down. So I always just kind of beat myself up. And it turns out, get better at it. So that's a good thing, too.
And as I can see, there's nothing broken.
Nothing broken. There are some bruises, but they're always in places that are never public because you're getting dragged on thighs and in hindquarters the entire time.
So that's a very nice way of saying that.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I did.
What about you, Alex? And also, just a quick...
It's a family-friendly podcast.
That's right. Just a quick, who is Alex Davy, for those in the audience that may not know still somehow?
I'm a guy, yep. You know, pretty much do things. I work for Fantasy Flight Games in the miniatures department, and I'm a game designer. Notable games that I've worked on for the company, probably the highest profile would be X-Wing and Armada. And then at Gen Con this summer, I was really excited to announce what I've been working on for the last year, which is Star Wars Legion, our first foray into traditional tabletop wargaming. So Wars Star, that's what I'm about. That's what I brought to the table.
Well, that's not a bad niche to have right now.
No, sure. the timing worked out well.
So what anything relevant in your past week of your life happening?
I don't know how relevant it is, but I do have a hot movie recommendation to drop on you.
Please.
The minis department has been running bad movie weeks every couple of weeks over here at my place. And yesterday we watched The Five Elements Ninja.
All right, I'm writing it
which
down.
It's about serving hot looks. It's about every ridiculous weapon imaginable brought into bear. It's about sheer ninja insanity. It's about buckets of orange-tinted Shaw Brothers-style kung fu blood. It's got it all.
everything you could ask for in a movie.
I can't recommend it highly enough. And after that, we were in a jubilant mood, so we busted out a couple of little indie kind of great party games that I'm a fan of. Nidhogg 1 and 2. If you haven't played those, check it out. They're dumb. They're great. And then Super Pole Riders is another old game.
That's so good.
I can't recommend these highly enough. They're just dumb.
What's the objective of a game like Super Pole Riders?
So Super Pole Riders is, as you know, we all know, competitive 1v1 pole vault kickball is sweeping the nation. And this is the video game equivalent of that. You have these little pixel guys, and one of your you know, sticks controls the pole, and the other stick controls your movement. And so you're trying to pole vault up into the air and kick a ball that's suspended on a string between the two goalposts. And it's just floppy, stupid physics. You know, this game looks like it was made for about $500, but it's remarkably great. And my favorite mode to play is 2v2, where you each hold a single controller, or each team of two holds a single controller. One person controls the movement, the other person controls the pull.
So good.
And it's just nonsense. It's great. There's a pack of games called Sports Friends, and it's the same pack that has Johann Sebastian Joust in it, which, look that up, also phenomenal. The only good thing to use a PlayStation Move controller for, I think, that's ever been invented. So
I think the burning question for anybody listening at this point is, when are we going to see the tabletop port of this package of games? Because the idea of that kind of a game on like a dexterity game is really hilarious to me.
I could actually, Steven, you just got me really excited about that.
I want to expand you beyond Star Wars into these sports games.
Well, right? I like the idea of a tabletop game that comes with like 5 mini games.
Absolutely.
It's like the whatever the name of the package of games you just said was, and it has the 5 different like things in it.
I used to rent those like power pack discs where you had like the Olympic games or some series of it, yep. You know, fun things that, you know, that was hours. There was days of entertainment for sure.
Like skill-based tabletop games. I think there is a lot of really cool stuff out there. And it's not one of the things that certainly Fantasy Flight is known for. But it's a whole different... we do have one that I can think of, Dungeon Fighter. We published not a Fantasy Flight Studios game, and I suppose it would be under the Asmodee umbrella at this point, but it's a you roll dice onto like a target board and you're trying to slay monsters in a dungeon. It's pretty dumb. It's good though.
I like that your association with dumb and good games is like hand in hand.
Yeah, they're tied together, it seems like.
It's a matter of how much joy they bring.
Yeah, should we be a little worried about that Legion coming
out? I was going to say, I'm now getting slightly nervous about the future conversation in Nova in general. All right, Legion in general.
I talked to you guys about the mechanic where you can flip a tiddlywink onto Darth Vader to charge up his force powers. So I'm pretty excited about that.
That was an off video segment that we cut for
From the demo for your own sake.
Yeah. Anyways, so for me, I actually went out to Nova this weekend in the DC area, and it's a really cool fan run convention where like all the proceeds go to charity. They do a lot of really cool work, but it's very topical and because there's a lot of wargaming happening at this convention. Have you ever been to Nova, Alex?
You know, I haven't, but Frank's been a couple times and he has dropped some details on me. It sounds really cool. So it sounds like it does a lot of different games. It's a full weekend full of people who like tabletop miniature type games of all kinds. So yeah, I hope to make it out there someday.
Yeah, it was really fun. And the thing that really impressed me, I mean, miniature wargaming is a segment of tabletop that I have only like been around a little bit and for the longest time didn't really understand. But like at Nova, it's this, like there's rooms upon rooms full of terrain and these wild setups and like all these people playing. And so like you can just bring your army and it's like you can be playing on a new battlefield every hour and a half or every 6 hours, however long your game takes. And it was crazy. And then you actually had, and it's just cool because it was like this big section of people just hanging out painting.
Yeah.
And it was like,
oh, yeah.
You're just here the whole weekend hanging out painting. It's like, that's actually pretty great. And, you know, for the longest time I was into really competitive games and that was pretty much it. But now getting to see these communities and especially for miniature wargaming, we go to AdeptCon as well, which is where we get to see this kind of thing. And I don't know, I'm gaining a lot of appreciation for miniature wargames in general that I never really had before because I had never really seen it. It's like, well, it takes 3 hours to play, so I can't like compete at it. But it's also like it takes 3 hours to put a model together and paint. And it's like I'd rather just be playing. But a lot of those perspectives have changed. So I think to segue kind of into the real topic, I would be curious to get your take, Alex and Steven, on really why do people play miniature war games? Like, what is the appeal? What do miniature war games bring to the table that the other categories of games just can't or don't?
Alex, please take it away. Yeah.
that's kind of the heart of the matter, right? Because on the face of it, miniature war games make no sense. They're an enormous investment of time and labor. They require, many of them require tremendous space, you know, to actually like put the terrain on the table. Generally speaking, there's assembly, there's painting. Some people put hundreds, if not thousands of hours into unbelievably just gorgeous jaw-dropping armies. It's a whole hobby in the way that, you know, throwing together a deck of cards is not. You know, you can play a lot of card games, you can get really into the competitive side of things, but I would argue that that's more of a sport than a hobby necessarily. War games have all of these kind of barriers to entry, but at the same time, it's all is that very stuff that makes them so interesting and so appealing. Because once you have put in that effort, once you have found that community, once you are, you know, commanding an army of tiny, beautifully painted little soldiers across, you know, this battlefield, you kind of have this immersive experience that's not really quite like any other. And I think at the end of the day, that's kind of what it's all about. You know, like most of our miniatures games, you could play them without the models attached. X-Wing, Armada, you could play them with just the bases. But having those miniatures on the playing area helps with immersion. It helps you really put yourself in that setting. And that sort of feeling is just amplified a thousandfold when you have custom terrain, when you have custom painted armies, you've done it yourself. So I think it's a hobby for slightly crazy people, but it rewards the same elements that make it a little bit cumbersome also make it really, really cool. It's a unique position in the world of gaming in that it's so very demanding, but also those same demands are really rewarding.
Yeah, is it fair to say that as compared to a card game, you know, I think about L5R, we've been playing some here recently to kind of get ready for that launch and see what that game's about. But you're always playing with, you know, cards that have a specific representation of a specific character every time you play it. And with miniatures games, even pre-painted, pre-done miniatures games like X-Wing, it's that ship, and then maybe you can take it and customize it a little bit. But then you get into these war games, these really, you know, serious tabletop war games, and the amount of ownership that you have over that experience from top to bottom is actually quite ludicrous. Like the way mm-hmm. that you can literally glue it together differently, you know, you can add modifications with putty and those kinds of things. You can paint it in whatever color scheme you want, and even the mistakes you made or that time that you accidentally painted this when you should have painted that is a story that you bring with you to the table. So certainly, there can't be anything more immersive than that, right?
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, and we haven't even talked about the different ways you can base your figures, or all right. the like dozens and dozens of third-party companies that supply, you know, like custom resin bases, and there's powders that will weather your minis in a certain way. There's airbrushing and varnishes and different sprays and primers. There's dips, there's washes, there's shades. Like, and you see that, you know, some of the figures that the really talented people put together are just jaw dropping. Like Sarastro's Luke is a very straightforward paint job in terms of what he's actually capable of, but it still looks amazing. He's done some simple OSL lighting, and even just simple techniques can really take you a long ways. But yeah, it's definitely a different world, and it's not a world that Fantasy Flight has really tapped into before. So it's gonna be interesting to see what comes of that. I'm almost the most excited just to see what people will do with the miniatures and what terrain they'll build. Even just after the announcement, I've seen a couple of posts online about, you know, someone's building a Lothal table, and someone else has started putting together like Endor tree trunks and stuff. And it's just like that's what we're hoping for. We're hoping that this like fires people's imaginations and lets them create really whatever they want with a set of rules to govern how that will interact with the game once it's finished.
Yeah, I think your analogy, I really like it. I had never really thought of it in these terms, but you said that like a lot of the, you know, card games or competitive games are more like a sport. And I do feel like the way I approach those is the same as I would with a sport, right? With like training and like preparing mm-hmm. and like that kind of thing versus something mm-hmm. like Legion, which is truly a hobby. Like all the miniature war games, right? Part of the reason you're willing to invest hundreds of hours in a painting is that this is your hobby. You're not investing. It's not like you're actually investing time. You're literally right. looking for that hobby, right? That community to be a part of.
I saw James Sawyer comes to our store, great, great community member. And I saw him sit down with an old game. You'd probably know it. It's like a Battletech Verdict Cavs, I think it is, CAVS. It's one of these old school ones, and set up this entire board of terrain and had a friend in Bo who was playing with him. But they set up all the terrain, sat across the table from each other and talked for an hour and a half.
Yep. That's about right.
They didn't even get into the rule set. The models were just, I don't even know if they ever got set up that entire night. So here's the other question, Alex, is our miniatures games like this, are they actually about winning at all?
You know, I think it's not as emphasized as it is in other games, competitive card games. X-Wing, I think, is a great tournament game because it's fast paced. It requires a lot of skill. It's simple, but there's depth. X-Wing is a really good tournament game. But as you get into longer, more deliberative, more sort of contemplative, hobbier type games like Armada and certainly Legion, the sheer size, scale, and time required to play these games mean that it's less about the competition and it's more about the experience. It's about bringing your custom army. It's about fighting on a new battlefield, seeing what might happen. Now, that being said, I don't want to give the impression that the game itself is not important, because the game is it's still a game. You know, it's still a two-player game that one person is – both people are trying to win. And so I would never say that the game doesn't matter, but – it's a competitive framework for something that's much more than just I won or they won. You know, like it's a way to sort of forge these interesting narrative moments, to tell kind of this story of a battle. And I think that unless the game itself is engaging and competitive and really makes you think, it doesn't do as good a job at immersing you in that experience. If it's just roll a bunch of dice, something random is going to happen. It's not nearly as interesting as like, oh man, if I can just get, you know, if I just get this AT-RT into position to wield its flamethrower, I can win this game. You know, I know what can stop it. I know what the parameters are. I've planned my strategy around it. And there's reasons for doing all of these things. And yeah, there's dice and yes, luck does play a factor, but I believe that in any game you play, skill should be the deciding factor. Not necessarily every single time, but most of the time. And I think that's important, even in a game that is lighter and less focused on, playing nine rounds in a big tournament.
Yeah, well, I get the sense that like with these games, you know, if you take away the game mattering or winning mattering, you remove a lot of what creates that immersion and that payoff. Mm-hmm. Even picturing like, you know, you started mentioning the Lothal boards and the Wookiee boards. And it's like the idea of like taking my Vader stormtrooper army and like, you know, because there's a point in the movie where he's just all in on finding Luke, right? And it's like mm-hmm. he's making questionable decisions, sacrificing thousands. Even in the, mm-hmm. I was recently reading Lost Stars, and it's like, it's this a segment where the Executor is going into the asteroid field to get the Falcon. And it's like, one of the captains, it's in her head, and it's like knowingly killing thousands of soldiers for this. And anyway, mm-hmm. so the rules being this, like there's an objective and I can play Vader like I'm trying to hunt down this character, right? Like that's mm-hmm. how I'm approaching it. And the rebels are trying to steal the plans and run away with them. And so but it's still not about the why behind why you're playing isn't the win, but the win right. is what sets the stage to create the story.
Yeah, and I think with Legion in particular, I wanted the focus to be on that narrative experience. So in Legion, you will never have a game where you're just trying to eliminate the enemy forces. Certainly, eliminating enemy forces helps you win because they're not shooting back at you anymore. And yes, in the unlikely event that you do completely wipe out an enemy army, you do win that game. But I can count on one hand the number of times that's happened in the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of playtests that we've had. The meat of the game is really going out and achieving objectives. And they're not specific story objectives. They're relatively all encompassing. You know, intercept the transmissions, pick up the supplies. But the spin that you can put on those simple objectives is anything. You know, those might be the Death Star plans. Those might be Kyber crystals you're after. You know, and people can tell those stories during the game, and it just makes it more exciting. It makes it more interesting. And another thing that wargaming does really, really, really well is campaigns. A bunch of people getting together, playing through a big campaign, adding their own objectives, their own ideas to it, battles that matter in the overall storyline. And that's the cool thing about a system like this, because you can pick it up and you can put it on all of this pre-existing terrain or terrain that you've built custom for it, and you can change the parameters of play dramatically just by moving to a different, you know, 3-foot by 6-foot table. Yeah. So that's the stuff that gets me excited. Like, that's what got me into hobbying in the first place, was seeing that and wanting to do that and be a part of that. So I'm hopeful that we can see a bunch of super cool Star Wars stuff in that realm.
Well, let's talk about the Legion rule set, the game of Legion, since we're here anyway. There's a number of tabletop war games, and honestly, I guess some of the longest running games in history are tabletop war games, all the way back to things like BattleTech and even Proto, you know, before that, where it's kind of the battleground of what's happening. Like, basically, I have role-playing games and I have kind of these big battles, and they're kind of growing up together. And you have a lot of these long-running things, which, as we've talked about, have a lot of investment in them. And a lot of players have built a lot of models and painted a lot of things. And now you're dropping this new one into the space. And certainly, it's hopefully going to attract some of those people to it. And then hopefully, it will introduce a whole lot of new people to this genre. Like, Zach and I, honestly, will probably be introduced fully to this genre through Star Wars Legion. What?
Well, yeah, you know, it's funny. It goes back a really long time. Like, the H.G. Wells wrote a book called Little Wars in 1913, which was basically the first tabletop wargaming rulebook.
Wow. Uh-huh.
Which is over 100 years ago.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah, and so, like, that spawned a lot. And I'm sure there was stuff even before that. But that's like the one of the earliest, like, published codified systems, and it was Napoleonics, it was historical stuff. So people have been pushing tiny little lead soldiers around for more than a century.
Well, that's very relevant. Does a game like Legion, does a war game at this point in the history, does it need to do something groundbreaking? Does it need to bring some new grand element that we've never seen or experienced before? Or is it simply about optimizing, getting out of the way, making the rules as streamlined as possible? Where do you fall on your approach to designing a war game like this?
That's a great question. Legion is not trying to reinvent the wheel here. This is not trying to, you know, create 4-dimensional chess. We're not trying to do something that's never been done before. What we are trying to do, and what I hope that we have done, is create a competitive, fun, compelling game that has a few innovations and some interesting new mechanics, but is fundamentally a clean, simple, easy to access, but hopefully fairly balanced and competitive war game. But you're right, a lot of it is just about getting Star Wars on the tabletop in this really immersive way, playing these pitched battles, these sort of medium-sized firefights, which you see so much of in the trilogy, and letting people reenact those. I think that's the key element. That's the most important thing. And then any sort of wrinkles on, you know, game design that we've been able to throw in, little innovative touches, hopefully will feel like a natural fit rather than that we're trying to create an entirely new play style or a new type of game.
Well, I think for me, you know, I played the one demo game that we did on video, and I'm excited to play more. But I've always been fascinated with the concept of boiling something down to its essence. And mm-hmm. one of the hardest innovations is actually removing complexity mm-hmm. instead of adding it. So, you know, you mentioned wanting to make Legion accessible. And so how big a part of, you know, the innovation or the creation of this game was trying to boil it down to its essence, keep it accessible and not let it get cluttered. You know, I assume there's not going to be a 200-page rule book that has like all the nuances that a typical war game rule book might have. But how was that like a specific part of the prompt or the process here? Or how did that just naturally flow out?
No, that was a design goal of mine for sure. I think that in general, when I'm working on any game, I try to ask myself whether a new mechanic is worth the cost in terms of complexity. And sometimes you're 5 years into a game and you just need to do something innovative because all of the easies have been, you know, all the easy stuff has been done. All the gimmies are in, you know, in the bank, and you've got to do a little crazy kooky stuff to keep things interesting, to forge new ground. But like when you're starting from the ground up, which was kind of my experience with Legion, what I tried to do first and foremost was just boil it down to its essence and then build on top of that foundation. So one of the things that I've always found a little bit aggravating about war games is when you have 60 models and you're trying to move them around, you have to move each one of them individually. And so the movement system that I came up with is just a very easy reduction of that. You just move the leader and then you sort of position everybody around the leader. So does not cost you anything in terms of strategic depth, hasn't really removed any tactics or strategy from the game, but it has sped things up and made it cleaner. You know, ditto like just simple dice systems, simple morale systems. There is no like rolling on charts to see what possible, you know, out of 100 different weird results has happened. Because that stuff is fun, and there's a level of immersion in that I think a lot of people appreciate. But that was not what I was aiming for. I was aiming for something a lot simpler, a lot more stripped down. And I don't think you actually lose anything by, you know, not having a result that you can roll where your tank tracks are stuck in the mud, or you've lost your left, you know, ocular augmenter, and therefore your to hit rolls are -2 but only at long range or whatever. Like there's depth and then there's complexity for a reason, and then there's depth and complexity that's just kind of clutter. This is just my opinion, of course, because some people really do appreciate that granularity and that immersion, but that's not the game that I set out to make. I set out to make something that you could pick up and play and get on the table really, really quickly, and that the tactics of which would become more apparent as you go on. The mechanics are not the tactics. They're just a means to the end.
Well, speaking of complexity, I think a lot of players would wonder why derivate from the good old-fashioned measuring tape and D6 model?
Well, that's a really good question. It's tried and true, you know, measuring tapes, D6s. And actually, when we started development, we were using that. I think I was using D12s in the beginning, if I remember correctly.
Whoa, man, you would skyrocket D12 sales across the universe.
But what we looked at is how successful all of our other games have been using custom dice. And what we realized is that what you lose in granularity from a custom die, because the nice thing about a number die is you can peg any stat to it. You can be like, do this thing, roll 7 or above, you succeed or whatever. And that's adjustable. It's scalable. You do have a lot more room to grow in terms of design mechanics. But you also have to remember or look up every time you roll a die, if it means something different, there's a lot more like calculating, and it kind of pulls you out of it a little bit. One cool thing with custom dice is that it allows you to almost instantly know what's going on. Like within 5 minutes, there's a handful of symbols on these dice. You know what they all mean, and they are the same for every unit. You're always looking to roll hits and crits. The only thing that's changed is what you roll into the pool. And I think that that actually really does add a lot of immediacy. The other cool thing about symbols is it can let you do special stuff like the surge conversions and the critical hits. What we figured out is that just like putting one critical hit on every die, we were able to really easily and in a straightforward way handle cover and armor. A lot of games will have separate charts or armor penetration values or whatever. And when it comes to like, how do you deal with tanks? How do you deal with the big heavy vehicles? Legion's really easy. You need to roll crits. And if you have an anti-armor weapon that has, you know, impact 3, for example, that lets you turn 3 of your hits into crits, and then armor cancels everything else. So you already know what you're looking for. You don't have to ever pull out a rule book or go into a different mode. It's just a really simple way to handle something that is generally more complicated in wargaming.
So speaking of kind of things that are generally different or more complicated, and you know, even just the not having to go to the rule books, I think one of the things that struck me about Legion, because you know, I have played some war game ish games in the past, particularly like War Machine Hordes, and one of my favorite things in games at this point, one of the concepts I see over and over, is the idea of like I go, you go situation. Mm-hmm. And so in a lot of times in a war game, you'll have these, you know, like especially in tournaments, like a 10-minute turn to do all your things. And so, you know, effectively you have to make a lot of calculations before you make any decisions. And it's this complex thing. And Legion, again, it feels like keeps pulling back to the like simpler option, right? Which is we go back and forth. And not only that, but you also integrated the random command mechanic. So like was one of the design goals to have a quicker back and forth? And what was the process to get to the system you actually landed on?
Yeah, I always wanted to do alternate activation. It's just one of the things I think that is important with any game is that you be engaged. You know, you never want to just like go and you know, get a coffee, get a beer, come back 10 minutes later, you know, and see what's happened. And part of that is alternate activation. That's an easy way to get there because you do a thing, I do a thing, you do a thing. But another way to get there is to actually have the ability during your opponent's turn to make meaningful decisions in some way. And I think, there's a number of games that do that very well. Twilight Struggle is a good example of that. Destiny is a great example of that. You've got incredible interactivity and you're watching every move because it's important. And we tried to bring that to Legion as well. At the start of every round, you're not sure who's going to get the first strike that round. You're not sure what orders are going to come out. You're not sure what sort of special events might happen. So there's always this engagement at the beginning of a round. And then there are various mechanics in the game that allow you to hold your troops in waiting so that they can react to enemy movement. I think it's really, really important that anytime you're playing any game, you be in the game the whole time. Or your mind starts to wander, you get pulled out of it, and you're just sort of, you know, tapping your feet waiting for what's going to happen next. So there's easy ways to do that. And I think most of the minis games that Fantasy Flight does already implemented those beautifully. So it wasn't difficult to just continue that, that concept. The other thing I think that I did learn from our other games though, is that the importance of initiative is really, really huge. You know, who gets to go first that round can be absolutely crucial. I mean, I think if you look at Armada, being first player, getting to activate the first ship every round, it's a huge benefit. People will bring fleets that are squad point values are quite low in order to secure that advantage. And so one of the things that I wanted to do with Legion is make that more of a question. You know, the first unit that is going to activate every round is dependent on your command cards, and it's within your control. But the player who doesn't get to go first, who loses that fight, should also get a benefit. And the easiest benefit that I could think of was just like, well, if you're faster, if you're striking quickly, you're sacrificing more control, more command. The player who is taking his time to give his orders out in a more methodical way should have more control over their army. So if you play a 1-speed card and I play a 3-speed card, generally that slower or 3-pip card, that slower card, that 3-pip card is going to activate more units. It's going to give out more orders. So yeah, I might get the first strike, but then my army may be a little bit more chaotic. It may be a little bit less under my control as the game goes on. So,
you're talking about the other games, you know, X-Wing obviously being the probably most relevant / successful example of something you've been working on. I'm curious what lessons specifically you've learned from X-Wing that you took with you going into Legion.
Well, simplicity is really the heart and soul of that game. I mean, like the cool thing about X-Wing is you really can learn it in just 5 minutes and you know what's going on. But as you very well know, Zach, like mastering that game is no easy feat. There's a ton of tactics involved in that. And Jay Little really made a genius little game, because for something that accessible to be that tactically deep and to have such a compelling tournament scene is really remarkable. And I think that part of the reason for that is that the ships are constantly in motion. So you can't just hold back. You can't fortress up and you know, lob attacks from your side of the board to the other side of the board. You have to go out and get it done. You're forced into this momentum. Now, that momentum didn't make sense for an infantry game because it is all often about taking and holding positions. So you have to get there through some other means. And the way that we've done that is force objectives that require movement, that require getting somewhere and doing something. And that helps a lot. And wherever possible, we were able to crib little lessons from X-Wing, like the way the speeder bike works, the way vehicles work with sort of anything that's like a repulsor vehicle that needs to be moving fast to be effective in combat is going to have this compulsory move that you have to plan ahead for a little bit. So you do have to sort of factor that in. So it's kind of a mishmash of different ideas. But the biggest lesson I learned from X-Wing is that it doesn't have to be mechanically complicated to be tactically deep. And I hope that we've been able to convey that in Legion. A simple system that has a lot of tactical depth was my design goal from the start. Hopefully I pulled it off.
Tell me this about X-Wing and the kind of the long-term, you know, growth of X-Wing has seen a lot of complexity introduced, interactions introduced as you're linking cards together and synergies that can create issues. And you've got ways of dealing with that with errata and reprints and those kinds of things. But, you know, traditional war games, they're going to release a season manual or a codex or a league, about every year that kind of updates and spruces up the rules and cleans up a lot of these complexities that weren't anticipated with all the new content. So do you have any grand plans with Legion on how you're going to handle the kind of growth of the game in a sustainable and non-aggressive kind of way?
Yeah, well, one of the smart things that we've done, and I think something we're going to be doing in general a lot more, is the rules reference for Legion is going to be a living rules document, is going to be online only, and it's going to be a PDF that we can constantly update. So if we do need to make rules changes, which I think we've been very, very careful thus far to make a system that's very flexible and can sustain a lot, years worth of new content. But were we to need to do such a thing, we could simply go online and make that happen. And as we add new rules to the game, as we add new units with new abilities, that'll just update. Every time there's a new product release with new information, it will just go into its place in the rules reference alphabetically and easy to find in index and all that. So the game will expand, that document will expand very organically. So we're not tied to releasing a physical rule book ever. We can update that digitally. And meanwhile, the box will come with a really accessible learn to play that teaches you not only the basics of the game, but most of the advanced rules. And then you only really need to dig into the rules reference when you're in some very complicated situation, or if you really want to know the various nuances of, you know, this, that, or the other thing, you can really dig under the hood. But mostly that should be kind of a encyclopedic reference rather than something you need to read cover to cover.
So one thing we've talked about on several previous podcasts, right, is this struggle of, you said this whole like updatable digital rulebook has me wanting to ask some questions, which is, you've said, you know, we talk about basically, unlike digital games, right? It's like you release a computer game, you put it out to millions of people, they start playing on day mm-hmm. one. That very day you can release a patch, right? Change a stat, change a problem, do a thing. Even with the like games that kind of aren't just stationary, I guess, the ones that grow and have mm-hmm. online play and all that, you can change a stat and immediately the whole game can maybe change. So with tabletop, obviously the restriction is that a lot of times you physically print, in card games, you print a card. In X-Wing, right, you print a stat card and a base. Mm-hmm. And in Legion, you print stat cards and objectives and all that. So any thoughts on what tabletop games could do to give themselves? I think the rules reference being online only is an example. But, you know, like, is that a direction that is, as a designer, interesting? Does that give you more space to play?
I love the idea. I mean, if we're talking just personally, I think online squad builders, points cost that can be adjusted digitally, all of that stuff is really, really exciting to me. The pros of that, of course, is you can tweak units that are too strong or not strong enough. You can reassess the game a year in and figure out, you know, like, oh, well, we missed the mark here. We overestimated this unit or underestimated this ability. This is causing problems, that sort of thing. So from a, you know, from a personal standpoint, yeah, that would be great. That would be much more of a safety valve or a way to continue to make the competitive side of the game much more tighter in terms of balance. So the downsides to that, of course, is that you have to go somewhere specific to get your information. You don't have a physical thing that you can reference when you're building squads or imagining what your army is going to be. But yeah, I think it's something certainly to look into in the future. I'm a huge proponent of it. I can't speak for Fantasy Flight itself as to what we may have planned or what may happen in the future. But I think that as we sort of embrace digital technology more, and as just games in general become slightly more hybridized between physical components and digital components, I think that across the industry, you're going to start seeing much, much more of that. We've already seen that with certain companies, certain war games and such are already on that like online points-based system. The great thing about a miniatures game is that, yes, we put some points on the cards and that sort of thing, but when you have an army of stormtroopers or an army of rebel troopers, those minis don't have any stats or numbers or anything on them. Those are evergreen, which is why, you know, minis companies can print new rulebooks and be totally fresh. You don't have to change anything about that stormtrooper squad that you spent a month painting. Because the only thing that's changed is the rules surrounding it. The playing pieces themselves don't change at all. X-Wing, Armada, those types of games which have punch board chits with stats on them, that's a bit more of a challenge. But a game like Legion, you know, could be very easy, much, much easier to convert into a digital realm. That's not the route we're going to begin with. But it is certainly something to consider years down the line should we need to dive in and do some tweaking.
Yeah. Well, Alex, I have to ask you, I don't know if you can answer, but is there what's the reason for kind of reinventing what a lot of people would already say is a Star Wars miniatures game in the form of Imperial Assault Skirmish? You got anything to say about that?
Yeah, I think that until people have actually sat down and played Legion and really experience the game, they may not really grasp what a different game it truly is. Imperial Assault Skirmish is really fun. It's a really fun, tight little skirmish game with a handful of figures. It's got a deck. It's got round by round kind of actions. Legion is a much vaster scenario. It's the difference between a covert operation kind of mission in inside of a bunker and, you know, a huge roving battle where dozens of, you know, soldiers on both sides are fighting. So it's it'd be like saying, why make Star Wars Armada when you already have X-Wing? It's the difference between a dogfight and a fleet.
Yeah.
A fleet battle. And it's a totally different game, different system, different rules, different mechanics. So I think that once the game is out there, people will see that both of these games are their own thing entirely. And they don't really have a lot to do with one another, and they don't really infringe upon one another particularly because they have completely different mechanics. So it's just a question of scale, really.
Well, can you, speaking of scale, can you settle a question that Zach and I have with each other? Is Legion of the scale that could support an AT-AT?
Hypothetically, yeah. Of course.
You know, hypothetically.
It's only 22 meters long. Did you know that? I had no idea. I looked it up the other day.
No, it's not. They're not as long as you might think. They're really tall.
Apparently, Tim did the math the other day, and on a 6-foot board, and at the scale that Legion's at, it would take up about a foot.
A foot of the 6-foot board.
So, like, going left to right, it could easily fit.
And so that's reasonable.
That'd be cool.
Fair enough.
That'd be cool, Alex.
We could do a giant AT-AT, and it would fit Legion's scale, but it would be huge.
Cool.
You're not.
Is there anything in the mechanics that you're particularly proud of that we didn't cover in any of the demos or anything that's been out for Legion? I know that sometimes that happens when you're trying to teach the game quickly and you miss some of the more complex stuff that is maybe your favorite stuff about the game.
I think, you know, there's a whole suppression morale system that is pretty straightforward, but adds a nice little gloss of strategy to the game. And I like that system. It's a good system. But honestly, my favorite things about the game are some of the simplest things. I really like having the hand of command cards and having the named commanders that you play with. They add a lot to the game. And I really like the sort of pregame little mini game that determines what kind of battle you'll be fighting, what your deployment zone will look like, what your objectives are, any special conditions. I think those little wrinkles alone, they're small things, but what has been the case in playtesting is every time I play, and I'm actually about to head back to the office and throw down yet another game of Legion, and
lucky.
Every single time we play, it's different. And we're going to continue adding to those decks and adding to the variety as the waves, you know, go on. And I just think that keeps the game interesting and it keeps the game fresh. And I'm actually still excited to go and play it because I don't know. I set up a battlefield full of like ruined buildings and trees and stuff, but I don't know if we're playing 6-foot edge versus 6-foot edge, or if we're going to be on the 3-foot edge going the long way, or units coming off from different sides of the board, or if we're going to be diagonal, like, and that's just deployment. Never mind what we're actually going to be fighting over. And the cool thing is, so like, I've been working with Luke Eddy on wave 2, and I don't know what he's bringing. He's going to be playing Imperials. I've got my Rebel list. I don't know what he's bringing. I don't know what the battle's going to look like. And that to me is what's so exciting about miniature wargaming right there.
Very cool. Well, you kind of did a nice job of answering my final question for you before we get on to question time of the podcast, which is, you know, for anyone that hasn't ever played a war game, or for people that maybe have played a war game that are kind of on the fence about Legion, what really makes it worth trying out?
I think if it is something that appeals to you, maybe you've never picked up a paintbrush, maybe the concept of assembly is daunting. I really think Legion does a great job of being that introductory game. because all of the models are extremely easy to assemble. They are, if you've seen any of the Rune Wars stuff, they're big, chunky joints with specific shape, geometric shapes to them, so you can't assemble the models wrong. Honestly, I think you can build a core set in like an hour, even if you've never done it before. If you can, you know, if you can put a Lego kit together, you can put a Legion kit together. And in a lot of ways, Legion's way fewer pieces and way quicker. You just need a dab of glue. So I think the approachability of the models is huge. The size of the models, they're a little bit bigger than many other games. So they're easier to assemble. They're easier to paint. I think that helps a lot. And I also think it's the kind of game that unlike a lot of tabletop war games with you know, a mountain of rules and supplements and various special forces and special scenarios, you really can just pick up a box of this and play your first game within a couple of hours, which is, I think, somewhat unique in the field of miniature wargaming. So I think if it is a hobby that's always kind of appealed to you, you've always wondered about, it's a really easy and accessible way to get into it. I really believe that. We've tried really hard to make that the case. So I think that's paid off both in the plastics you get in the box and also the simplicity of those opening battles.
Very cool. All right, well, we're going to move on to some questions, which we have some answers from previous questions and then a new question. So we're going to read some answers. We talked last time about why games fail.
Mm-hmm. And that's why we have you on now, Alex.
And anyway, so the question we asked at the end of that show was, what do you think makes a game successful, or what's a really important factor? And Jeremy Springer on YouTube said, tournament play that is consistently happening with some prize support / participation involved. All the LCGs and CCGs type games I've ever played died once tournament play lagged or ended.
And I wonder if we could sub out tourney play with organized play, like we often do.
Probably. I think there's a difference.
But it's just people playing together, right? You got to have an opponent. You got to have people playing and have an active scene.
I also wonder on that if it's kind of chicken and egg, mm-hmm. where does the organized play and tournament scene dry up because
development of the game problems, goes sideways?
Of any number of other problems, yeah. Right? I mean, that's a sign that things are not going great, mm-hmm. probably. But I'm not sure. You know, I mean, there's plenty of games that I assume, like early on, they didn't have big organized play tournament structures, and somehow they found a way. So that's interesting.
Alex, you have any input on like why games fail? Just a real quick blurb. Have you looked at this as a designer?
Well, I think, you know, the interesting thing about competitive games versus, say, board games. Like a board game, it sits in your closet. You bring it out when your friends are over. You can play it today, and then you can not play it for 10 years, and you can pull it off of your shelf, and it's got everything you need. You just need to add people to it. So it's evergreen in that sense. You know, I can still go back and play, you know, Mousetrap if I wanted to. I wouldn't need anything else. But competitive games, minis games, that you need a community. You really do. Like, as soon as all the people stop playing X, Y, or Z locally, it's not that much fun anymore. So you do need to sustain that community. I think that's very, very, very crucial. And when it comes to card games, that's about tournaments. It's about new products so that your decks can do new and exciting things. It's about keeping people interested in the game. And as games go on, that just gets more challenging because you have to add new mechanics and you have to add exciting things, but you also have to do that in a way that doesn't subvert what made the game fun to begin with. So it's a really delicate balancing act just from the product development side of things. And then the flip side of that is that you have to have a bunch of people playing this game and who want to keep playing this game. And part of that is new products, and part of that is just the natural die-off. You know, you get really into something for a long time, and eventually you're just not necessarily going to play it as much. There's a natural cycle to that, unless it's your favorite game of all time ever. You know, I don't play as much Netrunner as I used to. I still love the game. There's still stuff coming out for it. There's still plenty of organized play. But it's just, I've played hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of games of it, and it's not the first thing I reach for anymore. So that's going to happen. And that requires fresh blood in the community. In minis games, there's like a further element to it, because there's this hobby side of things. And like, part of what is so appealing about these games is like hanging out and painting with your friends, showing off your latest creation, building terrain, getting together. So it actually requires even a further support system. You need a place to play. You need a local store that's got terrain that you can play on. So I would say that more than any other type of gaming community, the miniatures gaming, wargaming community really needs to be just that. It has to be a community to succeed. And so I think that we're very cognizant of that as a company. And Legion in particular has some things going for it. If we're talking about like specifically what is the viable communal life of Legion, well, one, Star Wars. Star Wars is an existing, huge, dynamic and very passionate community, and there are already groups in place who are fans, who are united by the stories, all over the world. Two, there's already a lot of people who play Fantasy Flight Star Wars games, X-Wing, Armada, that kind of thing. So there's existing Imperial Assault. There's existing communities in that respect. What is going to be the biggest challenge for us is to really, I think, push the hobby aspect of it. I know we want to create a lot of how-to guides and articles, how to build terrain, how to paint your models. It's one of those things that really, like, the older wargaming people, the veterans, have to bring in those fresh players and be like, hey, no, sit down at this table. You know, these are the paints you should buy. Here are some simple techniques to get you started. It's really fun. You know, we're here every Thursday night and we hobby and we play games, and it's great. You know, like, I have friends that I made when I moved to the Twin Cities through wargaming that I'm still super, super good friends with. And we may only ever play, you know, say Warhammer Fantasy, once a year. Part of that is because the game is no longer supported, but the community of people who paint and play games was there. So we were able to move into other games. We a bunch of people got into Infinity at the same time and kind of developed that. So I think the key with any hobby community is just to like be welcoming. People who are experienced can bring the new players in, and you kind of build it from all different angles. From an organized play standpoint, certainly we're going to be running tournaments. We're going to be providing tournament kits. I also hope that there'll be, you know, I can see scenarios or campaigns or what have you, I think, is a perfect game for that sort of thing. So anything that we can do to help foster that community, we're definitely going to do. But you're right. It's one of those things. You need that group of people to keep it alive.
Sure. All right, we're going to go on to a question from Sal V on YouTube. And for those listening, you can use the hashtag AskCovenant. We'll answer your questions right here on the show.
Or Alex will.
Or whoever is on the show will. So be sure to ask the questions. We've had some really good ones lately, so appreciate that, and keep doing that. So Sal says, my question to you is about FFG's Legion reveal. Thankfully, we have Alex on for this one. I love the idea of troop combat in the Star Wars universe, but do you feel that the gaming community would have a better been served with an X-Wing scale vehicle combat game? It could cross over with existing X-Wing ships as an air support, and the overall scale, such as an AT-AT, could have been a better possibility.
What do you think, Alex? Did you make that wrong?
I think that's an awesome idea. That's not Legion, but that doesn't mean that it should never or will never exist. Legion is an opportunity to tell character-driven stories. It's an opportunity to really, you know, put Darth Vader on the table in a war game in a meaningful way. You know, if he was X-Wing scale, it's hard to imagine what that figure would look like, what his powers would be. It's a different kind of game. And Legion is an attempt to tap into the hobby market, like we've been talking about, that you know, tabletop wargaming, paint your models, build terrain. And that, I think, works better at the scale that we've chosen. That's not to say that a ground combat version or addition to X-Wing is impossible or not worthy of doing, because that sounds freaking rad. Like, I would play that game. You never know. But it's a totally different process, and it's not the game that we were building. We were building this game to tap into the hobby market, essentially. And an X-Wing expansion or an integrated system like that is a different kettle of fish. It's fundamentally.
Can you tell us whether Legion's going to be doing stuff outside of the original trilogy?
trying to sneak one in, right? I have to end here.
I don't know how much I'm allowed to talk about, but it doesn't sound like a crazy idea. I'll say that.
Right. Yeah, that's a great answer. All right. Well, when we have guests on, Alex, we do like to allow them to ask our audience a question. So I'm sure if they're listening right now, they're going to speedily go to the comment section and answer this question.
Go on.
What would you like them to tell you, Alex? What would you like to know about our community of listeners?
Well, if you're still listening to me at this point after an hour of Legion talk, I'm going to go ahead and assume that you're interested. So I'm curious, what would you like to see in the game of Legion? What unit or commander or what have you do you want us to make a rules for and a sculpt of?
Nice.
Excellent. Great question. Thank you all so much for listening. Remember, you can use the hashtag AskCovenant to get your question answered on the show. Answer Alex's questions, and until next time, keep playing.